This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The History of the Ten Lost Tribes, Anglo-Israelism Examined by David Barron. Preface. A few words of explanation are needed by way of preface to this little book. More than 20 years ago, being often appealed to by friends for my judgment on Anglo-Israelism, or to answer questions which were addressed to me on this subject, I finally, after making myself acquainted with the positions and arguments by which the theory is supported, drew up a statement in the form of a letter to an inquirer. This letter, somewhat amplified, was printed in the form of an appendix in my book, The Ancient Scriptures and the Modern Jew, whence by special request it was subsequently reprinted in pamphlet form under the title Anglo-Israelism and the True History of the Ten Lost Tribes, a separate edition of it having also been published in America. This pamphlet is now out of print, and being appealed to by prominent Christian friends to bring out a new edition, I felt constrained before doing so to re-examine the whole question anew and more thoroughly than before. To this end I have read through, with much inward pain, I must confess, a number of the more recent Anglo or British Israel publications, which for the most part are mere repetitions of one another. The result is the treatise now in the reader's hands, which will be found to consist of three parts. In Part 1 I have dealt with Anglo-Israel assertions and claims, and the arguments by which they are supported. In Part 2, which is constructive in its character, and in which the greater part of my original letter to an inquirer will be found embodied, I have tried briefly to trace the true history of the supposed lost tribes, and in Part 3, which is altogether new, PGIV, I have further analyzed some of the scriptural proofs of a separate fate and destiny of the ten tribes from that of Judah, and have added notes and explanations on some of the more plausible points brought up by all Anglo-Israelite writers. The epistolary form, which is retained in Parts 1 and 2, is accounted for by the relation of this new booklet to the original letter to an inquirer, which is embodied in it. Let me ask the reader's Christian forbearance for any expressions in this little work which may be regarded as too severe. I would only say that if the unbiased reader had had to wade through the amount of Anglo-Israel literature, with all its fearful perversions of scripture and history, which the writer has had to do in the course of the preparation of this little work, he would most probably have felt as he did, the difficulty of putting a restraint upon his spirit so as not to use much stronger language. Toward the persons of the propagandists of this theory, I have, I trust, no other feelings than those of Christian charity, but the theory itself I cannot help regarding, after a close study of its principles, as subversive of the truth, and as one of the dangerous delusions of these latter days. After this little book was finished, an honored friend in Brighton sent me the article by the late Dr. Horatius Boner, which appeared in the Sunday at Home in 1880. I add it, with the permission of the proprietors of that magazine, as an appendix, in the assurance that the testimony on the subject of so honored and eminent a servant of God will be welcomed and carry weight with many. David Barron. Part 1 Anglo-Israelism Examined. Anglo-Israel Assertions and Claims. Dear friend, I shall endeavor to comply with your request, and to give you in this letter a few reasons for my rejection of the Anglo-Israelite theory. I can sincerely say that I am not a man delighting in controversy, and I only consent to your wish because I believe that you, like many other simple-minded Christians, are perplexed and imposed upon by the plausibilities of the supposed identifications, and are not able to detect the fallacies and perversions of scripture and history upon which they are based. The theory is that the English, or British, are the descendants of the lost Israelites who were carried captives by the Assyrians under Sargon, who, it is presumed, are identical with the Saxae or Scythians, who appear as a conquering host there about the same time. Or, to quote a succinct summary of Anglo-Israel assertions from a standard work, the supposed historical connection of the ancestors of the English with the lost 10 tribes is deduced as follows. The 10 tribes were transferred to Assyria about 720 BC, and simultaneously, according to Herodotus, the Scythians, including the tribe of the Sacae, or Saxae, appeared in the same district. The progenitors of the Saxons afterward passed over into Denmark, the mark or country of the tribe of Dan, and thence to England. Another branch of the tribe of Dan, which remained in ships, Judges version 17, made its appearance in Ireland under the title of Tuatha Dé Danann. Teffi, a descendant of the royal house of David, arrived in Ireland, according to the native legends, in 580 BC. From her was descended Fergus More, king of Argyll, an ancestor of Queen Victoria, who thus fulfilled the prophecy that the line of David shall rule forever and ever, 2 Cron. She. 5XXI-7. The Irish branch of the Danites brought with them Jacob's stone, which has always been used as the coronation stone of the kings of Scotland and England, and is now preserved in Westminster Abbey. Somewhat inconsistently, the prophecy that the Canaanites should trouble Israel, Numbers XXXIII. 55 Josh, XXIII. 13, is applied to the Irish. The land of Arzareth, to which the Israelites were transplanted, 2 ESD She. 45, is identified with Ireland by dividing the former name into two parts, the former of which is Erez or land, the later Ar or Ire. As to the Jews, quite a different history and destiny is marked out for them. They, as the descendants of Judah, are still under the curse. In fact, the Anglo-Israelite, by another and more mischievous method, is doing exactly what the allegorizing, or so-called spiritualizing school of interpreters did. The method was to apply all the promises in the Bible to the spiritual Israel, or the church, and all the curses to the literal Israel, or the Jews. But by this new system, while the curses are still left to the Jew, all the blessings are applied not even to those in Christ, but indiscriminately to a nation, which, as a nation, is like the other nations of Christendom, in a greater or lesser degree in a state of apostasy from God, though I thankfully recognize the fact that there are in proportion more of God's true people in it than in any other professing Christian land. I shall endeavor later on to show you the baselessness of the distinction which Anglo-Israelism makes between the ultimate fates of Israel and Judah, but let me first say that the supposed historical and philological proofs by which the theory is supported, most of which have no more basis in fact than fairy tales, are utterly discredited by competent authorities. Philology of a somewhat primitive kind, writes a prominent and learned Jew, is also brought in to support the theory. The many biblical and quasi-Jewish names borne by Englishmen are held to prove their Israelitish origin. An attempt has been made to derive the English language itself from Hebrew. Thus bairn is derived from bar, son, berry from peri, fruit, garden from gadar, kid from gedi, scale from shekel, and kitten from quitten, katen equals little. The termination ish is identified with the Hebrew ish, man. Spanish means Spain man, while British is identified with Barrett ish, man of the covenant. Perhaps the most curious of these philological identifications is that of jig with chag, hag equals festival. Altogether, by the application of wild guesswork about historical origins and philological analogies, and by a slavishly literal interpretation, or misapplication, of selected phrases of prophecy, a case is made out for the identification of the British race with the lost 10 tribes of Israel, sufficient to satisfy uncritical persons desirous of finding their pride of race confirmed by Holy Scripture. The whole theory rests upon an identification of the word isles in the English version of the Bible, unjustified by modern philology, which identifies the original word with coasts, or distant lands, without any implication of their being surrounded by the sea. Modern ethnography does not confirm in any way the identification of the Irish with a Semitic people, while the English can be traced back to the Scandinavians, of whom there is no trace in Mesopotamia at any period of history. The whole movement is chiefly interesting as a reductio ad absurdum of too literal an interpretation or misapplication of the prophecies. To this, let me add the verdict of a prominent Christian scholar. Commenting on Edward Hines' Identifications of the British Nation with Lost Israel, Professor Rawlinson wrote that the pamphlet is not calculated to produce the slightest effect on the opinion of those competent to form one. Such effect as it may have can only be on the ignorant and unlearned, on those who are unaware of the absolute and entire diversity in language, physical type, religious opinions, and manners and customs between the Israelites and the various races from whom the English nation can be shown historically to be descended. The fact of the matter is that the so-called historical proofs, by which the theory is supported, are derived from heathen myths and fables, and the philology which traces British to Bareth Ish and Saxon to Isaac's son, etc., deserves no other characterization than childish. It is in a misunderstanding of Scripture, and especially of prophetic Scripture, to which the origin of Anglo-Israelism can be traced. Coming across some of the great and precious promises in the Bible in reference to Israel, for instance, such as that they should be a great and mighty nation, and rule over those who previously had been their enemies and oppressors, and overlooking the fact that these prophecies and promises refer to a future time, when Israel as a nation shall be restored and converted, and under the personal rule of their Messiah become great and mighty for God on the earth, evidence of their fulfillment has been sought in the present. Now certainly these prophecies of might and prosperity are not now being fulfilled in the Jews. On the other hand, see how great and influential the British nation is in the world. Ergo, the British must be the lost Israel of the 10 tribes. The history and philology is, so to say, an afterthought of Anglo-Israelism, by which an effort is made to support the false postulate with which it starts. The scriptural identifications with which Anglo-Israel literature abound turn out on examination to be perversions and misapplications of isolated texts taken from the English versions of the Bible without any regard for true principles of exegesis. The way Anglo-Israel writers interpret Scripture. Some of their interpretations can only be characterized as bordering on blasphemy. Let me quote a few examples. 1. The glorious messianic prophecy of the stone cut without hands, which smote the image of Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel E., is applied to the British people, and the British Empire, which is one of the Gentile world kingdoms, is made to be identical with the kingdom of God. We will see what is to be the future of the British Empire, or in other words, the stone that smote the image. It is to become a great mountain and fill the whole earth. Our colonial empire, then, will continue to grow till it covers the whole world. We have tried to avoid extending our empire many and many a time, and yet God has caused it to grow larger and larger, and I believe will still do so. We are already by far the greatest empire there is, or ever has been, and we shall yet be far greater. The British Empire, again, can never be conquered. Daniel says, "The God of heaven shall set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, it shall stand forever." Consequently, we shall never be conquered, we must continue till the end of time, so that we are to continue to exist as the last kingdom or empire this world is to see. 2. Messiah's throne of righteousness and peace is made out to be identical with the throne of England, and the English people are the saints of the Most High, to whom all the kingdoms of the world shall be given. If the Saxons be the 10 lost tribes of Israel, then the English throne is a continuation of David's throne, and the seed on it must be the seed of David, and the inference is clear, namely that all the blessings attaching by holy promise to David's throne must belong to England. To this end, God is overturning, and will overturn, until the whole world shall be federated around one throne, and that David's throne, which according to the writer is identical with the throne of England, the only throne God ever directly established, and the only one he has promised perpetuity to. This kingdom is the fifth kingdom to be set up in the latter days of those kings, says Daniel. The kingdom was never to be left to other people. To her, that is, to England, was promised the isles of the sea, the coasts of the earth, the waste and desolate places, the heathen and the uttermost parts of the earth as a possession. Already, out of the 51 million square miles which compose the earth, England, including the United States, Manasseh, now owns about 14 million, say, one-fourth. She bears rule over one-third of the people of the earth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.